In the day's other news, confirmed cases of COVID-19 around the world topped 40 million. More than 8 million of those are in the United States, with more than 70,000 new infections a day. That's the most since late July. In Chicago, Mayor Lori Lightfoot made a public appeal to slow virus spread.
I understand that a lot of sacrifices have been made over these many months. And I also understand the fatigue factor that people have. But folks, given what we're seeing and the incredible escalation of the rates of cases every day, this is not a time where we can indulge in COVID fatigue.
Also today, the nation's top military leaders were cleared to return to work. They'd gone into quarantine when a senior Coast Guard official tested positive for the virus earlier this month. We're going to take a closer look at the wave of new COVID cases after the news summary. The Justice Department today charged six Russians with hacking everything from the 2017 French elections to the 2018 Winter Olympics to U.S. hospitals. The indictment says all six were or still are officers in Russian military intelligence, that's known as the GRU. That same agency targeted Democratic Party emails in the 2016 U.S. election, but the men accused today are not implicated in that hacking. Now, the U.S. Supreme Court will hear challenges to two of President Trump's key immigration policies. Today, the justices agreed to consider the so-called Remain in Mexico rule that's forced thousands to wait south of the border while the U.S. considers their asylum claims. And the court will also review the diversion of Pentagon money for border wall construction. Lower courts ruled against both policies. In Thailand, meanwhile, protesters against the monarchy and the government filled the streets in Bangkok tonight. Thousands held up cell phones in a massive light show defying a ban on gatherings of more than four people. Officials tried to censor news of the protests, and the embattled prime minister made a public appeal.
There is no plan to expand the state of emergency. The government is trying to compromise as much as possible. I ask this: don't destroy government and private property, don't do anything wrong, and most importantly, don't let there be fighting.
The Thai government also threatened legal action against anyone who promotes the protests on social media. There's been new unrest in Belarus as well over allegations of a rigged election. Several thousand retirees marched today, a day after more than 50,000 people turned out in Minsk. Riot police blocked main roads as protesters gathered on Sunday. They accused President Alexander Lukashenko of stealing the August election and demanded that he resign. He's run the country for 26 years. The U.S. Special Envoy to Afghanistan is warning about a new spate of violence. Zalmay Khalilzad says peace talks between the Afghan government and the Taliban could be derailed. Last week, a Taliban offensive hit Helmand province and triggered U.S. airstrikes. And on Sunday, a suicide car bombing in Khor province killed 13 people and wounded 120. Back in this country, meanwhile, firefighters in Colorado are battling a fast-moving blaze that's burned more than two dozen homes near Boulder. The so-called Calwood fire ignited on Saturday and was fanned by strong winds. About 3,000 people are under evacuation orders, including an entire small town. The largest fire in the state's history is also still burning. That's west of Fort Collins, but it's now 62% contained. And on Wall Street today, stocks slumped, as hopes faded for new economic relief before Election Day. The Dow Jones Industrial Average lost 410 points to close at 28,195. The NASDAQ fell 192 points, and the S&P 500 slipped 56. Still to come, on the NewsHour, another spike in COVID cases and its impact across the entire country. How caregivers are struggling in the time of COVID. Why fear is a motivating factor in these final weeks of the election, and much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.